So hi everyone, my name is Rudrank and today I am going to talk about speeding up iOS builds with local caching. You know, as a developer, your productive time is very important, and if your project is taking, like, let's say 5 minutes on a clean build and then a minute or two on a low incremental build, then you may get distracted and then you may go to Twitter and then you may go to the iOS memes channel and then scroll down all the memes. But if these 5 minutes add up to a lot of time, then you are wasting your precious productive time. So in this talk, I will talk about how you can reduce the build times using a new popular and trending topic, which is remote caching. I will talk about how you can use the remote caching tool and have a CI to upload the cache to a remote server, and then how you can use that server to download that cache or pull that cache to your local machine. So before I start, here's a brief introduction about myself. I have recently graduated from college last year, and I have interned at around 6 startups, and that included Apple, where I worked at the voice control team in the accessibility speech team. I worked as a freelancer before working for different startups and consulted one. I love writing, and I have worked as a technical writer as well as a hobby, writing more than 25 paid articles. And I recently published my book on exploring music kit, so you can also go check it out. And currently I'm working as the developer relations engineer at CodeMagic, which is a mobile CI/CD service, and I'm advocating and helping the iOS community. So just give me a second. There was this problem with my keys and the way I was changing the slides. So before I go on to the caching, and I won't go in much depth about caching, but you know that caching helps you fetch the files faster because it is readily available. So when you are working with Xcode, you know that when you do an incremental build, it is a lot faster than your clean build because the Xcode caches that into the derived data. So Xcode pushes the cache into derived data and then you pull it, but everything that happens there is on your local machine. And on the other hand, if you are using a CI/CD platform, a CI/CD service, you may use a CI cache that is on the server to speed up your CI builds. But you have to know that these two are different. The local cache is only on your local machine and the CI cache is only on the CI machine to speed up the CI builds. So if I talk about remote caching, it is a new and popular trending topic where the idea is that you compile once and then use it everywhere. For example, if I compile it on my machine, send it to a remote server, then other people in my team, other developers in my team can use that same cache without building it on their own locally, the building the targets locally on their machine. So if I have to explain it with a diagram, we have a CI which is pushing the cache to a remote server. This remote server can be a REST that accepts REST methods like get, put, and then from that remote server, you can pull that cache into your machine to speed up your builds. So there are many tools out there like Bazel by Google and XCRemoteCache by Spotify. And in this talk, I will talk about XCRemoteCache, which is a remote caching tool by Spotify. It has two modes on which it works. The first one is the producer mode, which produces the cache. Preferably, you can generate the cache on a CI build. Let's say you are caching on the main branch and sending that to a particular server, and then sending it to that particular server. And the second mode is the consumer mode, where you are getting the cache from that server locally and pulling it to your machine. You are getting that cache from the machine server and then locally pulling it to your machine. So for this talk, I have prepared a demo, which is a project called as Upcoming Movies, which is by Alonzo. So if I just run the project and show it to you, So it displays some upcoming movies that are out there. And let's say, we have the bad guys. I'm really excited about this movie that is coming soon. So in this project, I have many targets. One is the main target, which is upcoming movies. Then I have the today's extension target, the widgets target, and then we have many pods as well. So when you are talking about caching, you should know that there should be an optimal caching rate that you are aiming for. For example, let's say if you're trying to cache all the targets that you have, let's say there were like 100 targets here and you're caching every target, then in that case, when you are saving that CPU power and reducing the build time, you're also, that offsets the time taken for downloading that cache from the remote server. And on the other hand, if you have the whole code base on as a cache, then when you make any changes into one particular file, then that invalidates the cache and that triggers a whole new build, and that destroys the purpose of having remote caching. So I will just do a clean build to show how much time it takes right now. So it shouldn't take much time, but we will get an idea how much time is taking for a clean build. So it takes around 15 seconds for the build to succeed. So now we will go about talking about how we can integrate the XCRemoteCache into our project. And one thing before I go to that is, let me just show my screen. So for the server part, I am using Amazon S3, where I have created a bucket called remote caching that will hold all my cache. And you can use your own server for this purpose. So if I go to projects, to the file, so when you are describing, you have to describe all the things that you want to cache and don't want to cache into a particular file. For XCRemoteCache, the file is called as rc-info. Let me just zoom it out. So here you are describing the primary repository of your project, the branch on which you are working, the cache address. For me, it is the remote caching on Amazon S3 bucket, and then the secret and access key for these services. I will delete the key, so don't try to copy it. And when you are done with describing the configuration, the second part is to make sure that you are working, putting the cache on the server using preferably a CI tool. So for this talk, I'm using Code Magic, but you can use your own CI provider if you are using that. So for when you are putting the commands, you are usually use a YAML file for the configuration. So I have the Code Magic YAML file where I will describe all the steps to upload the cache to the server. The first thing that I want to mention is that, as I previously said, that the configuration file contains my AWS secret key, and that is confidential. So I have to make sure that it is encrypted somewhere. So I go to the environment variables, and here I'm going to encrypt the configuration file so that I don't have to commit it to Git and make everyone use my S3 bucket and get a huge bill or something. So I will just start a build before I go and talk about the configuration. So the next step is that I install the pods for this project. And to set up XCRemoteCache, we have this particular command for the producer where I am providing the name of the project as the input, the mode is producer, and the targets that I want to include is upcoming movies and the upcoming movies widget extension. As I mentioned, for me, this is the optimal caching rate that I want. And the final producer target will be my upcoming movies. And the next script will be that I want to build the IPA on, so that this, when I'm building the IPA, it stores the cache to the remote server on my Amazon S3 bucket. So I provide it with the name of the workspace, the name of the scheme, as I'm as it is for development purposes, I will not provide the code signing identities. So if I go back and wait for my build to happen, in the meanwhile, let's say you are using Coca pods in your project. So you may want to use a plug. So XCRemoteCache also has a plugin called as Coca pods plugin, as the name suggests. So for this, let's you provide the same configuration that you provided earlier in the RC info file, but instead now you provide that data into your pod file. You just name the plugin, and then in that you provide the cache address, the primary repository, the mode that you want, the final target, your access secret access keys, and the primary branch. And all you have to do is just pod install. In that case, you don't have to do write any commands for producer in that case. So the updated workflow configuration will look like, for the first thing will be you gem install the Coca pods XCRemoteCache, and then you pod install. And the next step is similar to what we did earlier, which is we build the IPA on your CI platform. So while this build is happening, I want to show you on the Amazon S3 bucket. If I go to, when you create a remote cache, it is divided into three folders. One is file, the file contains the actual cache, the metadata contains the metadata about the files. So, and the marker is the identifier for each file. So let's say on the metadata side, I have a file. So, just give me a second. So you can see that the time right now is 5:30 PM and a cache has been generated at this time. And as I mentioned earlier, you get this file on metadata that contains all the files that you have. For my case, let's say if I just zoom in, it says that the file upcoming movie widgets extension JSON file, and the other is the upcoming movies file. So if I just open this JSON file, you see that it contains all the files in that particular targets. It's small widget view, your upcoming movies widgets, your search widgets, the widget provider. So let's say you are working on the main app and you don't make any changes in the widgets file, widgets target. So it compares all the files, and if there's no change in this particular target, then we can use the remote cache for this target instead of rebuilding on our local machine, and thereby saving us time. So let's say if you have many targets, let's say you have 20, 25 targets and you're working on two or three of them. So you don't want to build all of them when you're doing a clean build. You only want those two to build, because those two are where the new changes have happened. So now if I go back to my project, we can see that it was a successful build and the IP has been built. The XCRemoteCache has been set up, and if I go back to my remote cache server under the files, I can see that a cache has been generated of around 4 MB. When you are working in a bigger team, this size will be a lot more, but for a sample project, I think that is sufficient. So if I go back to terminal and just clean the screen. So the next command that we want to give is that we want to execute the consumer mode and get the data from our remote server. So the command for this is XCRemoteCache, XCPrepare, and you provide it with the input file, which is the upcoming movies target, and the mode is consumer. And the targets that we want to include is the upcoming movies and the movies extensions, as we discussed before. So I'm getting an error that XCRemoteCache cannot be initialized with the consumer mode because there's no artifacts to use. So if I just try to do a log, So it says that network requests failed with unsuccessful code 404. So we can see that there has been some issue, and it looks like Xcode does not want me to reduce my build times. But nonetheless, when you do this command, in the morning it was running fine, and the time that I was getting was around 12 seconds, and without the remote cache I was getting, as we saw earlier, it was 15 seconds. So that's a time saved of 3 seconds per build. And if we talk it about in percentage, that's a decrease of 20%. And I think that's pretty great, because these times, the reduced times, will add up over time. So if I go back to my slides, so now that we have talked about the pros of using remote caching, we also have a limitation. And I think the one of the biggest limitations that I have found is working with Swift Package Manager. Because when you are working with packages, you cannot specify the build settings for it. And the tool like XCRemoteCache cannot specify which file to skip compilation or not. And I think if you're working with Coca pods, then you don't have to worry about it. But if your project consists of a lot of packages, then this is something that you have to keep in mind. And coming to the conclusion, remote caching is a great way of reducing your local build times. And you have to understand the differences, that it helps you reduce the time on your local machines compared to the local cache that you have that is only for your machine. So when you're using this concept of remote caching, when you are pushing the remote cache to the server, then everyone in your team can use that cache on their machine and thereby reduce time instead of building that target locally themselves. And another option that you have is just to ask your manager to give you an M1 Ultra, and I hope that will reduce the time automatically. And with that, I conclude my talk. You can find me on Twitter at RudrankRiyam. I'm very active there. I open source my projects on GitHub at RudrankRiyam. And on my blog, I write about Swift UI, iOS development at rudrank.blog. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Rudrank. Okay, yeah, it looks like somebody just commented live demo gods are not happy. I do have one question. What is supposed to happen with the one that failed just now?
So the idea is when I run that command, that puts my project into the consumer mode. It readies my project to run in the consumer mode. That means that my project will now use the cache generated on the server instead of building the whole project again. So XCRemoteCache will detect the cache from the remote server, match it against, if the invalidate, it matches against the if there has been any change in the files, and if there has been not, it will just use that cache from the server instead of triggering the whole build on my machine.
I see. Okay, yep. Okay, there is a support for SPM. Okay, but I think for Franklin, expand more on the issue with SPM. How is the compatibility with SPM? Do you know any of this program?
I think the last time I worked on XCRemoteCache, I don't think I found any compatibility with SPM, but I will look into this.
As in any incompatibility or compatibility?
I will look into the compatibility with SPMs, because I think it was specifically explicitly mentioned in their documentation that right now they don't support. But I think, let's see if the documentation has been updated.
Okay, right.
I think even if I just go to the documentation right now, it says that the SPM are not supported.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, thank you so much.